Well, you notice by the title of the sermon, when stones are being tossed, that it has to deal with something about stones. And in your bulletin, there is a sermon outline that you can follow along. You can fill in the blanks if you desire to do so. And I do want to say thank you for our guests that are here today. We trust already you felt the warmth of God's presence as we shared in songs, we participated in worship. But before we get into the message itself, and I also want to say on a side note, if I get carried away and you're not able to fill in all the blanks, you can always go on the website, go to our media page, and there's the outline of the blanks already filled in. So you can even cheat, not do anything this morning, and just go to the website if you want to. But before we get into our scripture from John 8, verses 1 through 11, I have a question I need to ask you. And you look like a very intelligent audience out there, so I believe you'll be able to help me with this question. Just where in the world is Eden? The Garden of Eden. Okay, it's just a rhetorical question. I wasn't expecting an answer. But I have to admit, I'm somewhat confused this morning as I'm standing here, because I had this spot some time ago in a supermarket. They had a tabloid there, and on the front page, very bold, it said, Adam and Eve skeletons found. Now, that is very interesting, and being a minister, that caught my attention. Adam and Eve skeletons found. Now, we have to understand that we're not living in the Garden of Eden because they were kicked out. But somewhere in that area, they had to have found the skeletons of Adam and Eve. How did they do the DNA, the test, to be sure that it was Adam and Eve? But then, something else caught my attention. It was just as bold. Adam and Eve skeletons found south of Denver. South of Denver? I don't think they were anywhere near Colorado. If I know anything about the Bible and maps and other things, they're mistaken where Adam and Eve skeletons were found, because it wasn't anywhere near Denver, Colorado. But then I also read of a Bible college professor. Now you have to hear that all out. It's not a college professor. It's not a secular professor. A Bible college professor who told his entire class that he knew precisely where the Garden of Eden was. Knoxville, Tennessee. Knoxville, Tennessee. Now I'm even more confused. He even gave the street address. 215 South Elm Street. And when he told the rest of his story, I began to think, maybe he's right. Maybe he's not so wrong after all. Because he said this. It was on 215 Elm Street, when I was a young boy, I stole a dollar out of my mom's purse and ran to the store to buy a candy bar. Afterward, I was so ashamed of what I did, I came back to my home and hid in the closet. Mom eventually found me and asked, "Why are you hiding? What have you done?" You know, that's exactly where Eden is. It's the place where you and I lost our innocence and sin entered in, and our guilt drove us to hide from God. Wasn't it there in the garden that God said, "Adam, where are you? Why are you hiding? What has made you want to hide from me?" And guess what? There was another garden where Jesus even posed the same invitation to Judas. "Judas, why are you here? Why have you come?" The invitation was to come forth and make things right. But you know, something is very tragic today, and that is some people are still hiding in the closet. They dare not come out and face God and confess their sins and find the means of getting right with Him. So let's take a good look at our scripture this morning and see if we can discover anything we can pull out of it in John 8, verses 1 through 11. It says, "Jesus returned to the Mount of Olives, but early the next morning he was back again at the temple. A crowd soon gathered, and he sat down and taught them. As was speaking, the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in the act of adultery. They put her in front of the crowd. "Teacher," they said to Jesus, "this woman was caught in the act of adultery, and the law of Moses says to stone her. What do you say?" They were trying to trap him into saying something they could use against him. But Jesus stooped down and wrote in the dust with his finger. They kept demanding an answer. So he stood up again and said, "All right, well, let the one who has never sinned throw the first stone." Then he stooped down again and wrote in the dust. When the accusers heard this, they slipped away one by one, beginning with the oldest, until only Jesus was left in the middle of the crowd with the woman. Then Jesus stood up and again said to the woman, "Where are your accusers? Did even one of them condemn you?" "No, Lord," she said. And Jesus says, "Neither do I. Go and sin no more." Now that's a part of the text we can't leave out, right? He's giving her a new beginning. He's saying, don't continue in this kind of behavior because you will face consequences. Go and let your life show that there's been transformation. Well, there are several ways you and I can deal with the sin issue, and I'd like to pose them to you this morning. First of all, you and I can be enslaved by what I call the if-only syndrome. The Word of God, as it was spoken through the Apostle Paul, tells us that we all have sinned. Even the one standing here on the platform, every one of us in this room has fallen short of God's expectations and His righteousness. Romans 3:23 brings that out. All sin comes short of the glory of God. In other words, we all have skeletons in our closets. How many would agree with that? Okay. Some of you spent some time pulling those skeletons out and dealing with them. And I dare say, if we're completely honest, we have to admit that if it wasn't for the grace of Jesus Christ, there would be many things in our lives we wish we could change, that we wish were different. Graciously, those have been washed away. The blood of the Lord has taken care of them. You know, I'm a Buffalo Bills fan. Most of you guys realize that. Some of you have prayed for me. Some of you want to hold me over and anoint me that something else would happen in my life. But I am a Buffalo Bills fan. And I was excited during the draft time when they used some of their draft capital to come up into the draft to get a quarterback. Now, the quarterback they got is Josh Allen, and I'm really excited about what he may do for the Buffalo Bills. However, as soon as he became part of the franchise of the Bills, they began to talk about some of the things that he said. Tweets came out about racism that was going on with Josh Allen because of comments that were mentioned by him when he was 14 years old. 14 years old, he said things that they thought were racist. Now let me ask, how many of you said some things at 14 years of age that you regret if you had to go back and listen to them again? I mean, I probably said a lot of things at the age of 14 that I would not appreciate hearing again if they were repeated to me. And I probably said a lot of things at the age of 14 that would be very offensive to today's snowflakes. But the truth is, it's 14 years of age. Many of us, though, however, still live in a world of if only. If only I'd done that. If only I didn't do that. If only I said this. If only I didn't say that. And I kind of sense that this is where the woman is in today's scripture lesson. I'm sure at this point, when they come in and they catch her in the act of adultery, she's wishing, "Oh, if only I hadn't given in this moment. If only I could turn the hands of time back and undo the events that are happening right now." Because she was fully aware. All of Israel was fully aware of the law and the consequences of breaking the law. So over and over in her mind, I almost can hear her cry, "If only." Especially as she's being pulled by her executioners out into the public square. Can you imagine how humiliating that was? Being pulled out in front of the church. Jesus is at the temple, mind you. He's there having a worship service. service. He's there with the Spirit of the Lord upon him, and everyone is glorifying God, and boom, they have to pull this lady in the front in the midst of all of that. But I'm sure in her heart, she's like, if I could just do this over again. And I believe that you and I can also be imprisoned by the if-onlys. In fact, we can spend the rest of our days wrestling with deep regrets if we don't deal with the sin issue. Every one of us. And that brings me to something else. You can live with if only, but also you can refuse to acknowledge that there even is a sin issue in your life. Now understand, God loves us. John 3:16 makes it clear that he loves us. He loves us unconditionally. But even though he loves us, in his eyes, we're still three dysfunctional people. How many would agree to that? How many say, yeah, you know, there's a lot of things God's still working with on me. I'm dysfunctional in many ways. And we're so wrapped and entangled in our sin that no amount of therapy can unravel us. We are powerless in ourselves to fix the sin issue, no matter what kind of self-help gurus try to tell you. They can give you all kinds of information, all kinds of methods and procedures and principles, but really, as Jesus deals with the sin issue, it's always going to be present. Now, I do want you to know, for anybody that might be interested, on Monday nights, we run Celebrate Recovery. It's not a self-help ministry, but if you have any issues in your life that have overtaken you, that have imprisoned you, this is a great place to come on a Monday night from 6 to 7:30, because in our Celebrate Recovery, they share how Christ can break those chains and set you free. So I'm just making a plug for one of the ministries that we offer. But you know what really is appalling to me is that many people won't even admit to the fact that they have a problem. In fact, somehow they keep playing that record that tells them that they're okay just the way they are. And I think this is also being unveiled in our scripture text. It's the attitude that you see in the lives of the Pharisees. They always set themselves up as almost perfect in every way. Reminds me of the story I heard of a man who just bragged about all his abilities, his talents, his character. And finally he says, I want you to know I am a self-made man. And one piped in, yes, a perfect example of unskilled labor. That may very well be the case. But on this occasion, the Pharisees actually flaunted their self-righteousness right in the face of Jesus himself. As I already mentioned, Jesus was at the church. He was ministering to a needy crowd. There were people all around enjoying this very special moment. They were having what I would call, and I've done this in the past, they were having a zippity-doo-dah day. Yeah. How many remember that? Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-day. My, oh my, what a wonderful day. Plenty of sunshine in my way. Zippity-doo-dah, zippity-doo-dah. Hey, guess what? I just sang for you. You didn't leave. But it gets me, because here they are having this wonderful spiritual moment, and then out of nowhere, literally out of nowhere, come these tall, lanky, dastardly-looking villains, shaking their pointing fingers at Jesus, saying, hey, you, who knew Jesus? We have a problem here. And then they drag the woman completely in front of a crowd that is in the midst of worship, and they say that she was caught in the act of adultery. They make it very clear what she has done, the crime she's committed, and they say there's no second-hand information here. We caught her in the act. And then they point out the letter of the law, that which is written in the book of Moses concerning such an offense. She needs to be stoned to death. And so they say, Jesus, what are you going to do? Have you ever noticed that self-righteous people, those that will never admit to anything in their own lives, are always quick to point out the faults of everyone else? Hey, they spend a lifetime pointing out everybody else's faults but can't see their very own. And you also have to realize that the Pharisees were trying their hardest to trap Jesus. They wanted to put him on the spot, and it appears on this occasion they've done a pretty good job. They have the guilty person in hand with powerful evidence of the crime, and even the best lawyer in the land, I think, would have a hard time getting her off the hook. So what does Jesus do? Well, at first he does nothing. He just kind of kneels down, takes his finger, and starts pawing in the sand. Well, they're still adamant. Jesus, what are you going to do about this situation? So he stands up, he makes a comment, goes back to his knees, and starts drawing with his finger again. You and I do not know what he wrote in the sand. We can only speculate, because the Bible never says. However, there are many theologians that believe there were probably two profound things that Jesus did. Number one, he probably wrote in the sand, "Where is the man?" You say you caught this woman in the act of adultery. Well, as far as I know, adultery involves two people. Where's the other party? Because the law of Moses says that both individuals need to be stoned. And I believe what Jesus was saying is that you set this woman up so that you could try to trap me. Many believe that they actually paid, they, the Pharisees, paid a man to sleep with this woman so they already know what was going to happen and they could find her at the right time so that they could pull her out. And some even believe it might have been a Pharisee himself that was involved. Now that's all speculation, but Jesus would have been correct. If you actually caught her in this act, there had to be two. So where's the man? Then, another thought. What was Jesus doing the first or the second time? I wonder if he was beginning to write down the sin of every Pharisee present. And I wonder if the Pharisees were standing there like, let's kind of wipe that away, you know? Nobody's supposed to know that. I hid that. It's buried in my closet. I didn't think anybody had any idea that that happened. He might have been exposing them and their sins. And he stood up. Okay, if you're without these things I wrote in the sand, if you're perfect, you can throw the first stone. And no Pharisee dared to throw a stone, because if they did, under the pretense of what Jesus just said, they'd be saying they were God. They'd be blaspheming God himself. And so one by one, beginning with the oldest, they all began to move away. You see, Christ was unmasking the true character of the Pharisees. Christ's own goodness reminded them of their wickedness. His light revealed their darkness. And Christ's purpose wasn't to condemn the Pharisees. He didn't want to drive them away. Christ always was reaching out as if he did to any individual, trying to draw them to a place of salvation. But instead of acknowledging the sin in their own hearts and getting right with God, they denied the sin and chose in the long run to get rid of Christ, the one who was reminding them of their sinfulness. Listen, if you think that you're without sin, think again. And before you go around throwing stones, take a real close look at the gravel pit in your own closet. And that brings me to God's way of dealing with the sin issue. I want to share how God expresses this. Because maybe you feel much like the woman in our story this morning. You're caught in the clutches of regret. Note closely what Jesus does. He offers the woman the gift of a new beginning. He does not seal her in the if-only syndrome. He didn't say to her, you know, I don't understand this thing about you because this seems to be an habitual habit of yours. You know, you're always running around with a different guy and you're in bed with somebody different. You had many, many chances to clean up your act, but you didn't do it, you blew it. Truthfully, you ought to have been stoned. But I'm going to do something far worse. I'm going to allow you to live with a forever reminder of your sins and your failures. Is that what Jesus said? Absolutely not. Jesus responded quite the contrary. He said to her, don't let your past and your pain destroy your beautiful future. Let go of the if only. Confess it and give it to me. Then allow me to bring renewal into your life. What Christ did for that woman on that day, he desires to do for each one of us here in this room. He is interested in clearing our past. You see, he's more concerned about what you can become than what you used to be. Psalm 103, verses 10 through 13 says this. He does not punish us for all our sins. He does not deal harshly with us as we deserve. For his unfailing love towards those who fear him is as great as the height of the heavens above the earth. He has removed our sins as far from us as the east is from the west. The Lord is like a father to his children, tender and compassionate to those who fear him. You see, God is bigger than our badness. And his willingness to forgive runs deeper than our sin and our shame. I'm going to ask the praise team to come back to the platform as we wrap up. A military individual was sharing about his five-year-old and in a project in kindergarten. The five-year-old wanted to do something special for his dad for Christmas. And because his dad enjoyed smoking a pipe, he thought, I'm going to get him or bake for him an ashtray. So his teacher started to help him. They worked in the autumn all the way up to Christmas in designing this ashtray. And the kid painted it. He molded it. They fired it. It was beautiful. They did everything. It shined because of the work that was put into it. And the kid was so happy. He thought, on Christmas Day, my dad's going to open up all these store-bought gifts, but then he's going to buy my hand or open up my handmade gift, and he's going to wonder about the beauty and all the energy that went into it. So his heart was so happy about what he was doing for his dad. Well, the Christmas pageant came. It was just before Christmas break, and the parents came to the pageant. And then the little fellow ran to the room to grab his gift, and he put it in a package. As he ran out, he tripped and fell, and it went to the floor and broke in pieces. The military dad said that his son began to cry. I mean, it was just like, all that work, from autumn till now, destroyed. So he picked up his son and he says, look, wipe those tears off. You're a man. You don't cry. What do you think about crying? It's okay. It won't make a difference. When the wife stood in and says, what are you talking about? It does make a difference. He poured his life into this project. And so she grabbed the little one, wiped the tears from his eyes, and picked up all the pieces. And said, let's take it home and see what we can do. And the military father said, I, at that point, saw the hand. He said, God's reaching down to pick us up, to wipe our tears away, and said, just give me all the pieces, and I'll put it back together again. However, we know when God puts the pieces back together again, it's better than the original. He does a magnificent job, does he not? If you come with a broken and contrite heart, God will never turn you aside. So there are three options open to us this morning. We can deny that our sins are really that big of an issue, much like the Pharisees did. Or we can cry in complete hopelessness over our sins, much like the woman when she was drawn before the crowd, caught in adultery, standing before her accusers without any kind of answer. Or we can take everything, every broken piece, and give it to Jesus. You see, the truth of the matter is, no matter what you're going through, Jesus is always the answer. So as we stand and close in song and prayer, if God's been speaking to your heart in any one of these areas, the if only or not acknowledging sin, broken, and need to give the pieces back to God, the altar's here, we invite you to come.